First, the Prime Minister. This is a trying moment. Inflation is at a three-decade high, COVID is killing dozens of New Zealanders every week, and the government is trying to push through an ambitious program of reforms before next year's election. Jacinda Ardern agreed to two interviews with Q&A this year. This is our first for 2022. We get 20 minutes. And I began by asking the Prime Minister about the causes of the cost of living crisis.
What responsibility do you and your government take for New Zealand's inflation?
Well, the responsibility that we have is to help New Zealanders get through it. And that's where you'll see that we've been so squarely focused on where we can take that pressure off, taking it off. That's what the fuel reductions by taking off 25 cents of excise, making that direct impact at the pump has come in, half price public transport, and of course the cost of living payment which comes in from the 1st of August. All of those designed to ease the pressure through these coming months as we expect inflation to come away.
But my question is, what responsibility do you take for the inflation we are experiencing right now, for causing the inflation? Like I say, there are myriad international factors as well, but what responsibility do you take?
This is where, you know, I am, of course, happy to take very honest reflection on what could have reached us to this point. But when I look at the fact that we are in such company, as in, you know, whether you're looking at Asian economies or economies within Europe or the United States, Canada, Australia, we are all having this experience. And so that's where you look for those common factors. And the common factors are so often international. The fact that we are all recovering from COVID at the same time, you're seeing a lot of demand in the system, we're seeing those supply chain constraints, we're seeing the fact that goods are not moving around the world as easily as they previously have. You see at the same time, of course, the impact of the war in Ukraine and the impact that's having on energy markets. So, as I say, we of course canvass and look at what are the levers we have to reduce those impacts for New Zealanders. Very much causal factors global, our response domestic.
But I still want to focus a little bit more on the decisions you've made here, because your answer doesn't quite address my question. So even without all of the COVID relief...
It might be because I'm disagreeing with the premise of it.
Okay. If we strip out the COVID relief, since 2018... your government's core spending has increased on average almost 11% every year. It was your government's decision to expand the Reserve Bank's remit. So I want to know, what responsibility do you take for the inflation we're experiencing
right now? Let's break this down then a little bit. When you look at the increase in spending, and of course, as you've said, COVID driving a lot of that need for additional
spending. Since 2018, your core government spending without the COVID relief has increased 11% on average every year.
Of course, the way to look at core crown spending is relative to GDP. And when you look at that...
Has GDP growth matched 11% every year?
And again, if I could just finish my answer here. As a percentage of GDP, and of course, when you look at this period of time, relative, for instance, comparable periods like the GFC, then you see that we're in a relatively similar position in terms of that core crown spending. Coming back to the question you've raised, around whether or not one of the causal factors is the fact that in New Zealand we have a dual remit for the Reserve Bank. So we're interested in inflation, and we've also said we're interested in employment, because of course it does matter to us as a Labor government that we have people in the dignity of work. Now we see a number of other countries, both with dual mandates and without them, having similar experiences. So again, I think it's overly simplistic to say that's a causal factor, and I'll let the Reserve Bank speak for themselves as to whether they consider it too, but I've seen them rebuff that suggestion.
What is the point in a low unemployment rate if people with jobs can't afford to live?
Oh, and of course, this is why we're talking about a dual remit. We do want to make sure that we have, you know, as a nation, the Reserve Bank, yes, who is independent, but with an eye to inflation, but also with an eye to jobs. But if I may, let's look at the counterfactual there as well. It does matter whether or not people are in employment. Imagine a scenario, which is the scenario that was predicted as we came into this COVID period, where many forecast New Zealand would have unemployment at 10% or more. So yes, global inflation, we have a tough period, but we also predict that it will come away and we are well placed to recover because there are so many other elements of our economy that are strong.
You're making a $350 payment to approximately 2 million New Zealanders who qualify. Do you accept that will make inflation worse?
So the issue that we have there, of course, is, you know, do we do nothing through this period where we have to accept that times are very difficult for New Zealanders? Or do we seek to find a solution that can ease the pressure but have as little impact as possible on inflation itself?
Will it have an impact on inflation?
So the advice that we got from Treasury was the fact that it was time-limited and targeted would lessen any potential impact on inflation. Compare that to alternative measures like tax cuts, not so, because it's less targeted, less time-bound.
Some of your measures are indeed targeted, like this relief payment, but some aren't. And I look at something like the winter energy payment. There are now 80% of New Zealanders who will be either receiving the winter energy payment or the cost of living payment to support them through this period. Why wouldn't you target something like the winter energy payment to people who only need it? You're giving it to all super annuitants, for example. You're giving the fuel excise tax cut to everyone.
Well, let's break those down. So you're right. Taken as a whole, the winter energy payment, which only cuts in during the winter period, but does go to all those on government benefits, but also those who are on who are our super annuitants. That cuts in every year through winter, you're right.
But the not all super annuitants payment, need it, right?
Well, look, you know, the question I would have here is, though, for the most part, is it something that's highly beneficial to this group who, for the most part, often are either not working or very shortly tend to move out of our employment market.
The question I would have is it inflationary? And should the government be spending tens or hundreds of millions of dollars supporting people who don't need it at a time when inflation is
10.3%? So roughly over the entire period that it's paid, the winter energy payment, $700 for a couple over the course of the winter period. And we've had it in since we became government. We put it in place.
Fuel excise tax. How much does that cost?
If I just may very briefly, on the winter energy payment, I cannot look past the fact that those who are in receipt of it, is one of the things that I continuously have people raise with me, that it makes a marked difference. Our older New Zealanders turn on their heaters because of it. So I absolutely stand by.
I'm not suggesting no one should have it. All I'm suggesting is that by having much more targeted approach when it comes to things like the fuel excise tax and the winter energy payment, you might be able to save hundreds of millions of dollars in support.
Yeah, well, look, here I would say the alternative is to do none of those things, and we didn't think that
was acceptable. The alternative is to be targeted.
Well, in the question
of... is really valuable.
Yeah, and look, for the winter energy payment, it is targeted, and for the cost of living payment, it is targeted to those on 70,000 or less, our low and middle income earners. If I may, on the excise, because you've rightly raised that question, because it is something that is reaching everyone. That is
millionaires,
though,
billionaires receiving.
That is, of course, though, because alternatively, when it comes to transport costs, very hard to simply say that if we just target it, for instance, to an individual low income driver, how do you do that? Someone who is reliant on that form of transport for their work, for childcare, what have you. What we also know is that fuel costs knock on to other parts of the cost of living. If it's costing more to transport goods and services, that has a knock on. So the universal element there pays dividends.
Let me ask a couple of last questions then on inflation. I don't want to get into the rule it in, rule it out game. I'm sure you don't either. But if inflation continues to hurt, will you consider making additional support payments next year?
Here I would just say we've seen our willingness to do that because, for instance, we had the family tax credit, which we did at the beginning of the year. We then moved on fuel excise. Yeah. Then we saw that we were predicting the rates continue and we moved on the cost of living payment. So all I'm going to say there is you'll see that we've tried to be agile to the circumstances we see, and we will continue to just see what impacts these are having on New Zealanders and do what we can. We've got a way to go, though, as well on getting the food costs down, which is another big project for us.
Is there any policy or reform that you will consider delaying or scrapping to help fight inflation?
Well, here I would argue that those areas where you've had the opposition suggest, wrongly I would say, that investment has potentially been inflationary. Healthcare, the idea that we would, for instance, reduce the amount that we've put into healthcare.
What about the TVNZ merger, for example?
In terms, so
the $350 million.
Again, here there's just an assumption that spending, is in and of itself inflationary. It very much depends on where that investment is going. And so Treasury is also being very clear on that.
I mean, you are focusing on supporting people through inflation, but you also have a role in fighting inflation. And at the moment, the government's plan appears to be to stick with a record spend from the last budget and give $350 to 2 million New Zealanders.
A significant portion of which was simply the increased required in order to keep the services we have going. And so here, the challenge is the counter-narrative, I would say, the opposition coming at us and saying that their response would be to see a reduction in investment. That is a reduction in education, healthcare, law and order. Very much where those significant investments have been about maintaining and growing services New Zealand rely on, and I would counter questionable whether or not it would have impact.
Democracy has changed. We're in a consensus-type democracy now. We're not in a majority anymore. Do you know who said those words?
I wouldn't. Well, I've said many things over 5 years, so
you.
I wouldn't want to necessarily
paint
myself
you.
Into a situation of it didn't sound like me.
It is your Māori Development Minister. Willie Jackson says democracy has changed. We're in a consensus-type democracy now. We're not in a majority anymore. Do you agree with that?
Well, I would argue that consensus and majority, aren't we driving therefore for the same things? And of course, the emphasis being he is not in any way questioning the importance of democracy in that proposition either.
He's saying it's a consensus-type democracy,
well,
not a majority-type democracy.
Well, again, he's also... Democracy is democracy, Jack. That's, again, not undervaluing the role that individuals have to have their voice expressed, their voice recorded, and ensure that it has influence. If this is an argument somehow that the things that we are doing are not continuing to drive towards bringing people together in our democracy to drive consensus, that's something I stand by.
So is the governance structure for the regional representative groups under Three Water strictly a one-person, one-vote democracy?
Well, the idea that any governance board, where actually most of the time they do work to consensus, if you're arguing here that this is giving Māori veto rights, I would argue
against
that.
That's not what I'm arguing. I'm asking if it's a one-person, one-vote democracy. The way those boards are structured at the moment...
Yes, I do. If you're suggesting that we are undermining democracy...
That's not what I'm suggesting.
Well,
I'm asking if it's No, it is an important question. You've just said democracy is democracy.
Yes.
And by most people's definition of democracy, one person, one vote. So I want to know that under those regional representative groups, if you and I as Pākehā people have the same level of representation guaranteed as Māori people.
Oh, well, again, this is where I would argue this is such an overly simplistic response here to what has existed.
It's actually a very simple question that you could answer.
Jack, here, this is where I'd argue we have had this model of running entities for some time. The Waikato River Authority structure, a number of different council structures.
Not when it comes to the delivery of public services, though.
If I may.
Those are quite different.
If I may, though, the reason I'm arguing it's simplistic is because the ownership of these entities sits with local bodies and government. So it is not changing the ownership structures. It is not changing any issues around...
It's not changing
around
the ownership, but it is changing the representation. That's an important distinction.
Well, no,
If everyone has ownership of these assets, why isn't everyone represented in the same way when it comes to those
borders? Well, actually, local government maintain the ownership. They are the ones with the public
share.
I'm
not asking about the ownership. I'm asking about the representation on those boards.
And with these regional representative boards, yes, we have mana whenua represented and local government represented. But the ownership rights continue to sit with local government and with those local councils.
You still haven't answered that.
Well, I think it's again because I don't know that your question really is getting to the heart of the issue here. Many people believe that what is happening simply by the representation on these groups, which essentially are trying to draw together those across the region who, of course, have an interest in the good governance of water, to come together, mana whenua and local government, to, if I may, set the statement of intent and appoint the board who run the bodies day to day. The ownership sits with local people.
I'm not asking about ownership, I'm asking about representation, and that's what this comes down to. When it comes down to the representation on these boards, the truth is the structure at the moment, some would argue, gives Māori disproportionate power. That's the argument that someone
makes. The reason I'm coming back to ownership is for most people, power sits with ownership, and the ownership sits with local government.
Let's talk about COVID. For 2 years, you've said science would dictate our COVID response. We're in the midst of a massive surge, and all the experts have called for mask mandates in schools, ventilation standards, and a coherent mitigation strategy. With double-digit deaths every day, why aren't you taking that advice?
Well, here I would push back on that assumption that we haven't. You know, when it came, I'll take one example. Mask requirements in schools. Here, we were very open-minded. Our message to our experts was, tell us what the best move is here in this phase of pandemic management. they went out into education and health, sought the advice of experts, those who work across both areas, and came back with a very strong advice that, yes, mask use in schools is advisable and is what we would want to be pushing for, but that we should allow schools to determine how they implement their own mask policies.
It's an abdication of leadership. After 2 years you've set the rules, now you're at this incredibly contentious moment. You've thrown it over to schools, to principals and boards of trustees, and said, sorry, you have to deal with all of the dissent, no matter what your decision is.
Any suggestion that throughout COVID there has been any abdication of responsibility, I absolutely reject. I get our COVID numbers every day. I think about what we can do to protect people from COVID every day. And that's why when it came to a question like, what do we do with our kids in schools? We said, whatever you recommend is what we will adopt. The recommendation was that, yes, continue to strongly encourage masks in schools. But for some schools, they often will be managing tricky different situations with their class body. This enables them, if they choose to put a flat requirement or to have more nuance, if they choose to.
And deal with all the scorn that comes from their decisions.
I have trust and faith in our schools, in our school institutions, in our boards of trustees and school management, to therefore roll out the advice that we have provided to them. I have trust in them to do that. That is allowing them to take leadership as well.
The nurse shortage is so bad that on the weekend more than 20 Polytech students in Dunedin had to go in and pull shifts in the hospital. Are you comfortable with that?
And this is in a time where we have some of the greatest numbers in terms of training for our nurses as well. And of course, keep in mind, since we've been in government, we've been focused on lifting those nurses, and we've got over 3,500 more nurses operating since we came.
There's still a big shortage if you're getting Polytech students to go to hospital.
Well, actually, we want another 2,000 more, so even more than that. The issue we have at the moment, and our health workforce is doing an incredible job in hard times. Mm. One of the compounding factors, alongside the fact we need more nurses, so we've got existing vacancies, is that our health workforce, just like the rest of us, is getting sick. And so we are at a particularly acute period. We also have a significant plan, which is underway, to continue to increase our nursing workforce. But it's that dual issue, Jack, of trying to train and attract, because yes, we'll bring them in from overseas, but we want our own nursing workforce too.
Well, they're certainly working in Dunedin.
Well, of course, all I'm doing is acknowledging it is a tough period, but we are very focused on growing those numbers.
Will you reconsider that decision around your migration settings and put migrant nurses on the immediate fast track to residency?
Yeah, so again, this is where I come back to the issue that, firstly, I've done some comparison, looked at some of the other countries because we want to make sure we're competitive. And our track is very transparent and clear. Come and be a nurse and you become a resident.
It's better in other countries, though, undoubtedly.
Well, no, I would argue against
that, actually. How many nurses have applied to come here?
Oh, look, I would want to go and get some of our latest numbers because we've flipped from one system to a new system.
Surely we want to do everything we can to bring them in.
Yeah, but actually one of the issues, I think, more than the residency, because I get a bit of anecdata and feedback from nurses considering New Zealand, for them it's clear that they'll become a resident if they come a nurse here. Some of the issue is about their retraining and the cost of that. So we're looking at some of those issues, which I think might be a bigger factor than necessarily the fact that we ask them to come and stay as a nurse on their pathway to residency.
Just to be 100% clear, at the moment, no plans to address that.
Not at this stage, but as I've said, if there is evidence to suggest that is somehow a deterrent, but I haven't seen evidence of that so far, then we keep an open mind. But I think some of the other issues around training do need addressing, and we're looking at that.
I want to ask you a last couple of questions about the big picture. So you've been Prime Minister for almost 5 years.
Yes.
You faced your share of challenges in that time. But as well as the pandemic, there have been policy challenges at times. Mm. Kiwi Build was a failure when compared to your initial promises. The Polytech merger is a disaster in its current status. Despite the billions you've poured in, the Mental Health Foundation has been highly critical of your response in mental health. Kids Can says child poverty is the worst they've ever seen. When you compare your policy aspirations with the results your government has achieved, what have you learned?
Do you know what? I would not ever change the fact that we have always throughout been highly aspirational, that we have always focused on how we can make New Zealand better and setting out a vision for what that should look like. You will still hear me talk about New Zealand as a place that should be free of child poverty. Absolutely, because anything less, in my mind, anything less demonstrates that we don't believe that things can and need to improve.
Absolutely. An A for aspiration, an E for execution.
If I may, then, what you're asking me, essentially, is to shy away from aspiration, set your targets lower, set out ambition that is lesser, because then perhaps your scorecard at the end might say, well, you achieved it because you set out to do nothing. I would rather keep that ambition, and if I may, on each, you know, for instance, on child poverty, 66,000 children have been lifted out of poverty by this government. Is there more to do? Absolutely. On housing, no government has built as many state houses as we have since the 1970s. In fact, we're responsible now for 10% of our state housing. 10%.
And how's the state housing list?
Again, yes. And again, had we built at that rate since the last government, we actually would have almost met the state housing list that we have right now.
The thing is, I know you can dispute the characterisation, but the truth is these are not your political opponents making criticisms. These are people who work in the mental health sector, who work in the child poverty sector. And clearly, if you had achieved what you'd aspired to achieve, these facts wouldn't be in dispute.
But again, you're setting out that any aspiration that we should have should be in three-year cycles. I disagree with that too. New Zealand's problem as a nation has been that our political aspiration has been in electoral cycles. We will not solve intransigent problems of our time unless we are willing to think in the long term. Now, does that mean that you can build a new primary mental health system in 3 years and fix what is a significant gap in our health system? You can't. But we have started. We now have tens of thousands of sessions for New Zealanders, access through primary care in mental health that did not exist before. And now we need to move through the continuum of care and start dealing with the acute issues as well. But we will only grow at that tail end unless we start doing the preventative work, be it in housing, be it in poverty, or be it in mental health.
Very interesting comment regarding political cycles. I know we've got a wrap, so my last question then, when will you decide if you will stand for another term?
I've already said, I have no plans to go anywhere.
I thought I had you on that one. Thank you very much.